I've got a change coming and everything's gonna be all right. Come on, clap your hands like this, everybody.
Metropolitan Church, Hartford, Connecticut, where when you come our way, you make our day. We're delighted this morning to have you sharing with us as we share in this Mission Sunday experience. I hope you'll join us in singing that hymn, number 668 in our hymnal. We sing it on Overseas Mission Sunday, number 668, How to Reach the Masses, Men of Every Birth. For an answer, Jesus gave the key, saying, If I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all persons unto me. Lift him up. Come on, let's sing it together, after which Sister Dahlia will lead us in our affirmation of faith. Let's bless the Lord in our singing.
verse 1.
How to reach the masses in on every verse.
To judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Our anthem today is rendered to us by that marvelous, marvelous singing aggregation from Accra, Ghana, the Vocal Essence Choir. Young people who sing to the glory of God. They are sharing with us today Haydn's work, Achieving is the Glorious Work. Come on, let's be blessed by the anthem, after which one of the pastors of our district, the Reverend Brian Riley, who pastors the Clinton A.M.E. Zion Church in Ansonia, Connecticut, will read for us the lesson from God's Word. Be blessed by the singing.
Scripture reading for this morning's worship experience comes from the New Testament, the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 8, verses 8 through 15. And the Word of God reads, I speak not by commandment, but I am testing the sincerity of your love by the diligence of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And in this I give advice. It is to your advantage not only to be doing what you began and were desiring to do a year ago, but now you must also complete the doing of it, that as there was a readiness to desire it, so there also may be a completion out of what you have. For if there is first a willing mind, it is accepted according to what one has and not according to what he does not have. For I do not mean that others should be eased and you burdened, but an equality that now at this time your abundance may supply. Their lack, that their abundance also may supply your lack. That there may be equality. As it is written, he who gathered much had nothing left over, and he who gathered little had nothing lacking. The word of God for the people of God. Amen.
One of the great hymns of the church provides our backdrop to prayer today. All the way my Savior leads me. It's the hymn that we know. This choir, the middle church choir, has put a different twist on it. And they've titled it, Jesus Doeth All Things Well. You'll recognize the tune and it'll help you as it does me to center as we prepare to pray. After the singing, Reverend Sharla Weaver will lead us in the prayer.
Thank you. Let us go to the throne of grace. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you. We thank you for the day that we've never seen before. We thank you, God, just for this beautiful morning that we woke up with breath in our lungs and our eyes can see, that our limbs can walk and do everything that you called us to be. We thank you, God, for keeping us through this week, keeping us through our journeys, keeping us through the lessons you taught us this week, Father. We thank you right now in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for loving on us. We thank you for keeping peace in our lives, keeping peace in our jobs, peace with our families, peace with everything right now, Father. Lord, we thank you that even when things are crazy and it doesn't make sense, Father, you have given us the comfort of the Holy Spirit to keep us through. So we are so grateful, Father. Right now, Father, continue blessing us, continue lifting us, continue giving the light that shines upon us that comes from you, Father. Father, continue giving us strength to get through each day, giving us determination that no one else can give you, giving us ideas that no one else can give us, giving us new ways of making things different in the ways that you called us to be. You say we are a particular people, Father. Father, thank you for making us the unique creatures that we are, Father. Father, right now, we thank you right now for the wholeness in our lives, Father, the peace in our lives, Father, the understanding of what it means to be a child of God in our lives, Father. Right now, Father, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus, that whatever is in our hearts, Father, you have kept us strengthened. Whatever is in our minds, Father, you have kept us sustained. Whatever things that might have been said around us, Father, you always remind us that you are our keeper. You are our savior. You are our redeemer. You are our everything and our all in all. Father, we thank you even in the midst of emotions and pain, Father. You're still in the midst, and we thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for things that may not make sense, but you are there for us, Father. We thank you right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, touch our congregation, Father. Continue building us up, Father, that we are still standing on the promises of you. Even if we have not been together physically, but we've been in this realm right now, where we are right now, we thank you, Father. We thank you for our pastor, Father. We thank you for our first family, Father. We thank you for our ministerial staff. We thank you for everybody that keeps this oil running in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for our membership right now. We thank you for all those who are in Hartford, out of Hartford, all over the country and all over the world that is watching this broadcast right now. Father, touch their lives right now. Touch the situations. Whatever it is, lift your hands and allow God to do his will. Whatever he says, that is what we were called to do. Nothing more and nothing less. So, Father, we thank you for whatever it is that you have got us to do this week. Father, we thank you for those who are well, Father. Those who are in the hospital, Father, touch them right now where they are. Those who are preparing for surgeries, those who have lost loved ones, those who are feeling pain, Father, touch them right now and be their comforter through all that they're going through. Be the doctor in that operating room. Be the lawyer in that courthouse. Lord, be everything that people need you to be, because you said that you are omnipresent. You are everywhere, Father. So right now, Father, just have your way in every venue, every place, every place, even in the jailhouse, Father. Have your way in those places right now. Touch the hearts of men, women, and children right now, Father. Touch their hearts right now. Let them know that you're there. Touch their heart, that they know that you have given them the spirit of fear, that fear is nothing but strength and determination in you, Father. That fear is not what we say. It's not the boogeyman, Father. It is you teaching us to put our faith in you, Father. So we thank you and we trust you for everything that you're doing in our lives, Father. So right now, as we continue on with this week, Father, give us the new vision, give us the new determination to do whatever it is that you called us to do. Whatever's lives we're supposed to change, Father. Whatever's lives we're supposed to give a little encouragement to, Father. Prepare us for that, Father, but also prepare us for whatever the next move is, whatever the next situation is, Father. We thank you right now. So, Father, continue building us up, continue encouraging us, continue to see us through another day, continue seeing us through everything that we've been through. So, Father, that at the end you get the glory and nobody else can get credit, that we thank you for what you've done for us, and we give you the highest praise that anybody can ever give, and that is the praise of thank you and hallelujah to your name. So right now, Father, touch those who are on this broadcast right now. Whatever that need is, Father, you handle it in your will, in your way, and whatever that is, we will surrender to it all. So, Father, as we know, that you have loved us and given us nothing but unconditional love through this process. Continue giving us strength, give us determination, but also continue using and guiding us. And we ask this in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
As we prepare our heart for the preaching today, let me take a moment to present to you the person who has been designated and who has accepted to come and to challenge us in the Word of God. He is Snow Hill, North Carolina's gift to the A.M.E. Zion Church, having been born there, grew up, formative years, along with his parents and grandparents and the members of the Salisbury A.M.E. Zion Church in Faroe, North Carolina, now Wilson. Dr. Cannon has served in the vineyard of Zion many years, many assignments and appointments, Cape Fear Conference, Blue Ridge Conference, Kentucky Conference. He has served and served well. I think he's best known in our Zion, for in 1997, he was appointed resident missionary. That means he picked up his family and moved to the Republic of South Africa, where he served admirably a number of years as presiding elder and pastor in the Republic of South Africa, the Spotswood Church there. Upon his return to America, he continued in his trek toward serving God in this church, attending his schools in Snow Hill, where he continued his education at Livingstone College, his work at Hood Theological Seminary, and I could go on and on and on and on about this preacher. But you didn't come to hear about him. You've come today to hear him. He is married, and one of the interesting things about Dr. Cannon is he and I share a great fondness for a little lady in our lives. Yes, his wife is important. Yes, his children are important. But I tell you, he has been captivated by that first grandchild. Now, he calls himself Papa Diddy. And so he will be our preacher. I want to call him Reverend Dr. Papa Diddy, but that wouldn't be nice. So I'm going to call him Reverend Dr. Dwight Bernard Cannon, our executive director of the Department of Global Missions. I want you to hear him today as he allows the Lord to use him in the preaching of his word. After our virtual ensemble of the Northeast Episcopal District has rendered to us their offering of praise, write the vision, then I want you to hear Dr. Cannon for his grace and for his ability. Come on, choir, sing, and then let's hear the word.
Mm-hmm. the vision. Make it plain that they may run and not faint. Though the vision is only for a while, it shall speak and not lie. For if the Lord said it, you can count on it. He will do just what He said. Write the vision. Make it plain that they may run and not faint. Though the vision is only for a while, it shall speak.
Thank you to the Metropolitan A.M.E. Zion Church in Hartford, Connecticut, to the senior pastor, Presiding Elder Terry L. Jones, Sr. Thank you so kindly for this privilege and opportunity to share on this Global Mission Sunday. This morning, I want to share with those who are observing Global Mission Sunday from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 12. These words are recorded in the New International Version. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what one does not have. Let me read that again, if you please. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, and not according to what one does not have. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. From this verse, I want to proffer the subject, Zion, are you willing, able, and ready to share? Are you willing, able, and ready to share? Let us pray. Let me think your thoughts, O God, as you live in my soul. Let me help my fellow missionaries and missionaries around the world reach thy kingdom's goal. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Global Mission Sunday in the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church is a connection-wide, worldwide, dedicated moment when all of Zion Methodism unite as one in a great hour of giving to support the work of global missions. Every fourth Sunday in September, or any day thereafter, is earmarked, designated as that mission-motivated moment when those who are blessed to give do so in a worshipful manner, wholesomely, and willfully. This intentional giving is so important that it is listed in the Book of Discipline to unite all of Zion in this missional effort. Global Mission Sunday is as much about reflecting on our desires and intentions to share with others as it is about giving or sharing with others. Global Missions encompasses all the world, and the mere nomenclature global necessarily thwarts or prevents the mission's antagonists who complain about sending money, food, clothing, and other resources abroad when they say help is needed here. And they're right. But I contend that too many of these mission murmurers do not give anything abroad, nor do they give in their own homes, communities, churches, and their corners of the globe. Zion, rightfully so, we did away with the limitations of doing missions by emphatically saying we're not just home missions and overseas missions, we are global missions. We are acknowledging that we are here as missionaries and a missional church to give and to share globally, not just overseas, not just abroad, but we do missions here, there, and everywhere. I believe that God judges each believer according to their desires, or their deeds, if you will, their dedication to serving God by serving others. If judgment from God was only about the quantity or how much we give, then those who have would be judged more favorably than those who do not have. This message addresses the importance of understanding that just because you have it, it does not mean you own it. Everything you have is not necessarily yours. Too often the things we own really own us. Some people have money, and some people are possessed by their money. Do you own your house, or does your house own you? Our desires and intentions to give bespeaks our willingness to give. And while money and resources and supplies are so important, there's one thing I preached over 36 years, and I bring it to your attention now. Money is not necessarily the hero and they're all. Yes, we need money,
But money without the right intent is null and void. In other words, you can have money to buy some Stacy Adams shoes, but you don't have enough to buy feet to put in them. You can buy a great big car, but if you don't have what it takes to run that car is just a showpiece. You can build a great big mansion, but your money won't make it a home. You can buy you some buddies, but money won't buy you friendship. Preach, Brother Cannon, preach. Yes, our actual assessment of what we possess, of what we have to give, it demonstrates our ability to give. In other words, if you have it, you are in a better position to give it. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 10 through 12 says this, "And here is my judgment about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now, verse 11, finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your accomplishment of it, according to what you have, according to your means." Verse 12, our key verse, "For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has and not according to what one does not have." This text emphasizes the importance of assessing the ethos, the spirit, the intent, the attitude of giving over against the gift itself. Zion, we must, three things as I hasten, we must be willing to give, able to give, and ready to give. Are you Zionites, missionaries? Are you willing to give? Are you inclined or favorably disposed in your mind to act promptly, to respond with willing hands? Are you born or accepted by choice or without reluctance, you making a willing sacrifice? Being willing has a lot to do with your volition, your power of choosing. Zion, are you willing to give on this Global Mission Sunday and days thereafter? In our world, we see so much going on. The situation in Haiti needs us to be willing to give. The situation in Afghanistan, finding resettlement and replacement for those who are displaced, that needs our willingness to give. Now, the next point is not only being willing to give, but being able to give. The sad indictment is there are those who are able to give, but not willing to give. And then there are those willing to give and not able to give. So not only do you need a willingness and an intent, if you please, but you need to be able to give. When God has blessed you, you're not blessed to just talk about what you have and what, but you are blessed to be a blessing. You have been given that you might give. You have been blessed that you might be a blessing to someone else. Being able to give is having the power, the skill, the means, the opportunity to do something. Having skills or qualities which make it possible for one to do what they desire to do. Remember, that desire is your willingness. So when you're willing, then God will make provisions that you are able to do what you are willing to do. Having considerable skill and proficiency, even intelligence, has a lot to do with your ability. Are you able to give? Are you able to give? What do you have? Somebody said, "Well, I don't have much." Guess what? God doesn't want you to be able to give based on how much you have, but just the willingness to share the little you have can make a big difference. Your $1, $5, $10, you hear the TV evangelists talking about it all the time, but there are people right in the AME Zion Church who need that $1, that $5. There are kids in school who can go to school for a whole year for $120, and yet we complain about buying shoes or books that cost $100. I'm here to tell you, your little is much when you give it in the name of Jesus. Not only am I asking this day, are you willing to give? Are you able to give? But finally, are you ready to give? You know that famous TV evangelist that talks about get ready, get ready, get ready. What I'm asking you to get ready, get ready, get ready to give. Are you ready to give? Some people, my God, they can really take that song for granted. Precious Lord, take my hand. And that hand is so tight, so close. I mean, you bragging about how much you have. And you got to remember that even though nothing is going out of that closed fist, nothing can come in. So I'm challenging you to be ready to give with the spirit of willingness. To be ready is to be in a situation that is suitable, a state that allows you to be active and take action of any situation, to be fully prepared. When you're ready, you're prepared to give. Some people want to give and you've already planned to give next year, but guess what? This pandemic has shown us next year is not promised. You don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. But to be ready is to be prepared mentally, even physically, for to do some action or to do or to partake of some experience. Finally, as I close, I want to share with you from the hymn, the Methodist hymn, that famous Methodist hymn by Earl Mullet, who wrote in the turn of the century, even compelling young people to volunteer to help those who are fighting World War I. That song is applicable even today as we wage the war on this pandemic against poverty, against police brutality, against social injustice, against any and everything that keeps us from doing what God would have us to do. The question is penned and immortalized in this hymn, are you able? And I tweaked it a little bit, not just are you able, said the master by Earl Mullet, but I want to add, are you willing? Able and ready, said the master, to be crucified with me. Yeah, the sturdy dreamers answer, to the death we follow thee. Lord, we are willing, able and ready. Our spirits are thine. Remold and make us like thee divine. Thy guiding radiance above us shall be a beacon to God, to love and loyalty. Verse 2 says, are you, my adaptation, willing, able, and ready to remember when a thief lifts up his eyes that his pardoned soul is worthy of a place in paradise? Those who are struggling deserve a foretaste of heaven, even down here on this earth. Then verse 3 says, and I doubt, are ye willing, able, and ready when the shadow closes around you with the sod, the earth, if you please, to believe that spirit triumphs to commend your soul to God? The final verse that I want to lift up is, are you willing, able, and ready? Still the master whispers down eternity, and heroic spirits, I'm talking about missionary spirits. I'm talking about Zionites who don't mind giving. The heroic spirits answer now as then in Galilee. What are they echoing? What are they saying? They're saying, Lord, we are willing, able, and ready. Our spirits belong to you. Remold us, make us like thee, divine. Thy God in radiance above us shall be a beacon, a lighthouse to God, to love and loyalty. Zionites around the world, let us declare war, W-A-R. Let us declare war, W-A-R. W-A-R, willing, able, and ready. We must declare war on this pandemic. We can't sit idly by. We must declare war on all those things that hurt us in this world and hurt those around the world. We must declare war on homelessness, illiteracy, unemployment, and even corporate bullying. We must declare war. But the war we wage is being willing, able and ready to give what we can to all the people we can, in all the ways we can. Zion, are you willing, able, and ready to give and to share with those in need on our mission fields here, there, and everywhere? I end with 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 6 and 7. He which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he or she who soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully, everyone according to the purpose, the willingness, the intent in his or her heart. So let them give, not grudgingly, nor of necessity, because God loves a cheerful giver. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God Almighty.
Thank you so much, Dr. Cannon, for a rich word. I hope you've heard that word today. I hope you've heard it, and in hearing it, I hope you heard God speak to you. If you have, I hope you'll get up with us here at the Metropolitan Church. We would love to partner with you as all of us together partner with God. There are ways to get up with us. They'll be on your screen. I hope you'll take time to call us or email us or however you choose to do it. I hope you'll get up with us so that together we can walk the King's highway. I'll be praying for you. I'll be praying for your decision and praying for your success in this walk. God bless you now as we continue to move onward and upward for kingdom building. God bless your heart. God keep you so.
I know.
Thank you so much. In his preaching this morning, Dr. Cannon reminded us of the importance of blessing people. Everybody don't have as we have. Everybody does not enjoy the benefits, perhaps, that we enjoy. But the truth of the matter is God blesses us so that we are enabled to bless somebody else. It's giving time, and I hope today you will give. You know by now the ways of giving. I don't have to enunciate them again. They'll be showing on the screen. And I hope you'll take time to choose your choice. That's right, to make your decision about how to give. And I hope you'll give today in accordance with how God has blessed you. While we're giving, the ways will be on the screen. And Kurt Carr will be rendering bless somebody else. Come on, let's worship the Lord in our giving.
Thank you for your music, friend. You have blessed us all.
Because I'm blessed.
My vow.
Lord, sing the harvest.
Every time you bless.
Every time you bless.
Indeed, our service today has been richly blessed by the presence of Dr. Cannon, and I hope all of us heard the tenor of the message, and that we will allow ourselves to be used of God to be a blessing to our brothers and sisters who have need. I want to thank our guests who have shared with us in the service today. You know, when you come our way, you make our day, and we are just always delighted to have you. There are a number of announcements that will be scrolling at the end of the service. I hope you'll hang on for a little bit so you can take note of those things that will affect us in the days and weeks ahead. I also remind you, if you do not receive our weekly bulletin, our notices of concern, we hope you'll put your email in the chat, or if you prefer, just email us at the email address that you saw earlier. Ask to be added to the list, and weekly we will make sure you get our bulletin, our parish sheet, so you will have at hand what's going on in your virtual church for that upcoming week. We thank you again, and we pray God's richest blessings on you as you continue to sojourn with Him. Now, we've heard the word, we've heard the scripture, we've heard the prayer, we've heard the singing. God has spoken. The only thing we can say is hallelujah and amen. Let's focus on that closing salutation and then our benediction. Sustains us. May the one who lifts us, may the one who blesses us continue to be with us both now, henceforth, and forevermore. Amen. Thank God. Amen.
Thank you. testify. I was born in Haiti. My daddy was a minister. He believed in having churches in the hood, you know what I mean? He brought us to Newark, New Jersey after Brooklyn. 1108 South Orange Avenue. Let me take you back to what gospel, Caribbean vibes felt like in that church.
Hello, God. Hello. Hello, God.
Gentlemen, we got another testimony.
Damn,
talk to me.
I feel in the darkness of the night, and in the valley you're right by my side. And though I think it's strange, each time I run from pain, when that's the tool you use to make me right. So I say,
holy, 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 take your shoes off. Ground is holy,
so I say,
holy, holy.